Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In today's videos, I'm going to tell you about what we call symmetric probability space and the six basic continuum rules. So in particular, what we call symmetric probability space, it's something that happens when you look at some experiment with only a finite number of outcomes and you assume that all those outcomes are equally likely, which is a very typical case in practice. So examples of such things are, for instance, if you flip a fair coin, you have two outcomes, they are both equally likely with probability 1/2. If you roll a fair die, for instance, you also get only a finite number of outcomes, which is 6 in this case, and each number is going to come up with probability 1/6 and so on. So that's what we mean by symmetric probability space. Now it turns out that in this context, computing a probability, the probability of an event, is a little bit simplified because it turns out that this probability is just going to be the fraction of outcomes in this event. So in particular, this means that computing a probability is in fact reduced to what we call a counting problem, so something in combinatorics, a field of mathematics called combinatorics. And by the six counting rules, what I mean is that there are in fact six very popular counting rules that that occur very often in practice, and we are going to see those ones at the end of this video. So first, let me rephrase that more carefully. So what we mean by symmetric probability space is the fact that the set of outcomes that we called omega is going to be finite. So omega is finite. All the outcomes and all the outcomes in omega are equally likely. So it's intuitively clear in this context that the probability of an event is just the fraction of outcome in this event, and that's indeed what we do intuitively, like naturally. Even when we are kids, we just say the probability of this happening is just, well, I look at the number of possibilities such that this happened, I divide by the total number of possibilities, and that's it. However, right now, we cannot deal just with our intuition. Okay, we have some very well-defined mathematical framework called measure theory and probability theory. A probability is defined from this axiom called sigma additivity, and now what we want to prove in fact is not some very big revolutionary property in mathematics, but just that this property called sigma additivity is indeed going to imply this natural result that is kind of intuitively obvious. So the goal is to prove that the axioms defined in the previous video are going to indeed result in something which is consistent with our intuition. That's why I'm kind of spending time proving something that is intuitively obvious. What I want to do is just to prove that the axioms are indeed consistent with the intuition. And so what we know about a probability is just one axiom called sigma additivity. We know also that the probability of omega should be equal to one. So I remind you that sigma additivity means that the probability of an infinite union of events, so let's say from n equals 1 to infinity of events an that are mutually exclusive, should be equal to the infinite sum for n equals 1 to infinity of the probability of an. So we saw that in the previous video, but replacing p by mu, a general positive measure. Now we are back to really probability theory, so I just use the letter P. This is true only if those events AN are mutually exclusive. So I need to add this condition, AI intersection AJ should be equal to zero for all I and J that are different. So the way you can deduce from this sigma DCBD properly the fact that indeed the probability of an event is just going to be the number of outcomes in this event divided by the total number of outcomes in omega, it's going to take several steps. So step one is just to observe that if you take all those an equal to the empty set, you are going to have that the probability of the empty set is equal to the infinite sum of the probability of the empty set, which means if you call, let's say, P the probability of the empty set, you get that P is equal to P plus P plus P plus P plus P and so on. The only number that can satisfy this properly, I mean, in fact, there are two numbers, it's P equals infinity or P equals zero. In this case, because your probability is a number between zero and one that cannot be infinite, that means that the only solution is zero. So from the sigma additivity properly, we can deduce that L taking an equals the empty set for all n, we deduce that P of the empty set should be equal to zero, which is consistent with our intuition. Second step is to say that, well, this properly applies to infinite sums. But because now we know that P of the empty set is equal to zero, we can deduce that in fact this properly is also true for finite union, and then you have a finite sum here. How do we do that? Well, you just assume that maybe A1, A2 up to AN are non-empty events. You assume that all the other ones are empty. That doesn't change your finite union. That doesn't change your infinite sum becomes a finite sum and so on. So that means that from this property, you can extend the sigma additivity property to, in fact, finite union of events. And so you have a finite sum here just by assuming that after some specific integer n, all those events are empty. Okay? So this implies from this, I can deduce that, in fact, this is also true, this property is also true if I cut the sum and cut the union with a finite number of events, okay? And then next step is just to deduce from the fact that all the outcomes are equally likely, we still don't know, even if it's intuitively obvious, that the probability of each outcome should be equal to 1 divided by the cardinal of omega. Again, properly that is intuitively obvious, but we still need to prove it from the axioms. And for that, I'm just going to use this property here and just say that P of omega, which is equal to 1, can be also written as the probability of the union of all the singleton little omega for all omega in capital omega. So that's the union for all little omega in capital omega of the singleton. Okay, then we know that this is equal to this sum because now omega is finite, so I have to deal here with a finite union. We just prove that it's also the same as the finite sum. So why is that? Well, because I'm looking at all the possible different outcomes in omega. So indeed, we have singletons that are mutually exclusive. So this should be equal to the sum for all little omega in capital omega of probability of the singleton omega. Now we are using that all the outcomes are equally likely. So meaning all those numbers are equally likely. And by this property and the fact that P of omega is equal to 1, we know that they should add up to 1. From this, we can conclude that P of the singleton omega for all omega in capital omega should be equal to 1 divided by cardinal of omega. And then last step, so now to extend that to any possible event, What we can do is combine again this property that we call additivity, not sigmativity, but additivity, and this that we just found to say that now for all a subset of omega, so all the subset of omega in this case, because omega is finite, are going to be an event. Then you can say that P of A, and you do the same kind of construction, is equal to the sum, is equal to the probability of the union of all the singleton in F. So that's equal to the probability of the union for all little omega in A of singleton omega, which is again by additivity, it's going to be equal to. It's going to be, let me see, let me write the idea here. So that's going to be equal to the sum for all omega in capital A of P of the singleton omega. But by this property, we see that all those numbers are equal to 1 over cardinal of omega. There are A such probabilities, the cardinal of A such probabilities. So we deduce that this should be cardinal of A divided by cardinal of omega. So indeed, we were able to prove very rigorously, I gave a lot of details here, we were able to prove very rigorously that the sigma additivity property of the probability implies that exactly like our intuition tells us, in case there are only a finite number of outcomes and all those outcomes are equally likely, then indeed in this case the probability of an event is equal to the fraction of outcomes in this event, meaning the number of outcomes in the event divided by the total number of outcomes. So this result means that in many problems, the goal is just going to be to count the number of outcomes in omega and the number of outcomes in the event A under consideration. And I'm showing you here a picture of what I want to call the six main counting rules that exist like in combinatorics. There are other ones, but these are the most important ones. So they are divided into three categories called permutation, arrangement, and combination, and each of them can be with or without repetition. So think of permutation as a number of rankings. So you have a set of something, let's say blocks, and you want to look at the number of ways you can rank them. In the case where there is no repetition of the same block or there are possible repetitions, combination is about extracting a subset from a set of, again, let's assume blocks. Arrangement is something, in fact, easier to count, and arrangement is the combination of both. You are going to extract a subset and rank the element from this subset, and that you can think of that as the number of rows. That's the middle column. So each of them are with or without repetition. So let's look at the easiest case. The easiest case is the case where you look at arrangement with repetition. In this case, the goal is to answer the following question. It's what is the number of rows of k blocks such that each of these blocks can be of n different colors? And you can have repetition of the same color. So in this case, the answer is easy. Let's say, so you have a row of length k, and for each of the k blocks, you have n possible colors. So you have n possibilities for the first block, n possibilities for the second one, and so on, up to the last one. So it's just n times n times n times n. That's equal to n at the power k. Then, second case, which is slightly more difficult, but not much more difficult, it's the case of permutation without repetition. In this case, you have a set of, let's say, n blocks that are all different. Let's say they all have different colors. And you want to look at the number of ways you can rank them, the number of ways you can order them. So in this case, you have, again, n possibilities for the first block, but then because all the blocks are distinct and you cannot use again the same color, then you have only n minus 1 possible choices for the second block, and n minus 2 for the third one, and so on, up to only one possibility for the last block, which gives you n times n minus 1 times n minus 2, and so on, that is called n factorial. So you get n factorial possible permutation of n distinct blocks or objects in general. So next one, which is again, I'm going in increasing difficulty here, it's the case of arrangements without repetition. So in this case, you want to count the number of rows of k blocks chosen from a set of n distinct blocks. That looks a little bit like permutation, except that you are not going to use all the blocks. So you have a set of n blocks with, let's say, n different colors, and you want to extract from that a subset of size k, and then order those blocks. And so you can do that sequentially and just say, I have n possibilities for the first block. Then, because there is no repetition of the colors, then I only have n minus 1 possibilities for the second block in the row, and so on, and you go down to n minus k plus 1, okay? And so in this case, you indeed have a product of k terms. You can rewrite this n times n minus 1 up to n minus k plus 1 in terms of n factorial divided by n minus k factorial. So for that, you just write the whole n factorial. So that means you go down to 1 exactly like for permutation, but then you still have to divide to indeed obtain the expression on the left-hand side. You have to divide by n minus k minus 1, and so on up to 1. So that indeed gives you your n factorial divided by n minus k factorial. So now let's look at the top right cell in the diagram, which corresponds to the case of combination without repetition. And in this case, we want to count the number of subsets of k blocks that we can extract from a set of n distinct blocks. So for this one, I will need to do a little bit of reasoning on the board. So I wrote this again. We are looking for this quantity that I'm going to call CNK, because clearly that depends on two quantities, C and N and K, and C for combination. So the goal is to find that. It turns out that the trick to compute this number, it's just to artificially introduce some kind of saying that the order is important, okay? In fact, in this one, the order is not important, but I'm going to artificially introduce that. And instead of counting the number of subsets of k-blocks chosen from a set of n distinct blocks, I'm going to look at the number of rows instead. And there are two different ways to compute that number of rows, and that's going to give us an equation involving C and k, from which we can deduce the value of C and k. So here the idea is, what about the number of rows in this case? Well, the number of rows can be computed, and in fact, we already did it. That's exactly the case of arrangement without repetition. Okay, if we want, instead of extracting just a subset, but we want the order to be important, and so we have, so what you can do is extract those k blocks sequentially, one by one. And so you are going to have n possibilities for the first block, and then n minus 1 for the second one, and so on, and up to n minus k plus 1. And that's exactly the number we just saw before. That's n factorial divided by n minus k factorial. Okay. Then another way to count the number of rows of k blocks chosen from n distinct blocks, so rows instead of subset, is just to say, instead of taking the blocks sequentially, let's take all of them at once. So we take k blocks simultaneously and then we order them. That's another way to do things, but eventually we get the same, we count the same thing. You can think of a row as choosing sequentially k blocks, one after the other, or you can think of the number of rows as the number of ways you can extract k blocks at once, simultaneously, and then run them. And then, by definition, the total number of ways you can choose k blocks at once, that's exactly this number that we call cnk. So that's cnk. And then, you still need to run those blocks, and in this case, I'm going back to the case of permutation without trapeziation. We saw that the number of possible permutation of n blocks is n factorial. Here you want to rank k blocks, so that's going to be k factorial. And so eventually we end up with this equation. The number we are looking for multiplied by k factorial is equal to n factorial divided by n minus k factorial. And so we conclude that the total number of subsets here, that we call cnk, is going to be equal to n factorial divided by n minus k factorial times k factorial. So we have one more answer in our diagram. So next, let's look at the bottom left of the diagram that corresponds to the case of permutation with repetition. So in this case, I wrote here that what we want to count is the number of possible ways we can order n blocks. But in this case, there might be a repetition of the same color, and we call n I, in general, the number of blocks with color I. We have a total of n blocks, so n1 plus n2 up to nk, and k colors should be equal to n. So in this case, we can count the number of rankings by using what we just saw before, combination without repetition. And so the idea is to do the following. In fact, when you want to do your row of blocks, you are not going to choose them sequentially like we did before. That's not the best way to count them. The easiest way to count them is just to assume that you have n position like this in a row. And so let's call that position 1, position 2, and so on up to position n. And so what you want to do is look at the number of ways you can put those n blocks on this line. Now, you understand that if, for instance, I choose to put a black block here and a black block there, then if I exchange those two blocks, okay, I'm still going to get the same row of colors. So even if I permute some blocks, as long as those blocks that I permute are of the same color, then I'm not changing anything. So that's what makes the problem a little bit more difficult than a basic type of permutation without repetition. So in this case, first step is to say, well, choosing a row with those blocks is exactly the same as choosing n1 positions for blocks with color 1. Let's say color 1 is black. So, and let's say, for instance, n1 is equal to 4. And let's say n2 is equal to 3. And I'm going to use right for that. So, then step 1, I'm going to choose 4 positions for black. So, let's say this one and this one. And then I need to choose 3 positions for the red blocks, so maybe this and that, and so on. And I keep going like that. Let's say we have 3 colors and then 2 more, and then I have to choose those 2. So you see, you can really count the number of rankings by really saying from the n possible positions in the row, I'm going to choose n1 of those positions to be for the blocks with color for the block with color 1, and then n2 over positions for the block with color 2, and so on. So eventually, if you use this reasoning to count, you obtain that the number of ranking here is going to be, so n, from the n position you choose n1 position for the for color 1, then you need to choose n2, but not from all n positions, from the remaining n minus 1 positions. So n minus n1 choose n2, and you keep going like that. So n minus n1
minus N2, choose N3, and so on. And the last one is going to be N minus N1 minus up to minus N k minus 1, but choose NK, but those things add up, I mean, they are both equal to NK, so you eventually have NK choose NK. Meaning that when you chose the position for all the blocks with color 1, 2, 3, up to K minus 1, you have only one possible choice for the remaining NK blocks with color K. So that's the answer. That looks messy. In fact, you can simplify this a lot. If you extend this, you will see that it's equal to using the previous formula we proved. So that's n factorial divided by n minus n1 factorial times n1 factorial. Then you get for this term n minus n1 factorial divided by n minus n1 minus n2 factorial times n2 factorial and so on. This term is just equal to 1. And you see that here, this term simplifies with this one. Same thing here, I didn't write this third term, but here you, from this n minus n1 minus n2 choose n3, that's how we call it. So you are going to get this factorial that appears here again, so this simplifies. So eventually, you can prove that after simplification, that the number of rankings here is just equal to n factorial divided by the product of the ni factorial. So you get n factorial divided by n1 factorial times n2 factorial up to nk factorial. You can also write that in the form to remind that n is indeed equal to the sum here, n1 plus n2 up to nk factorial divided by n1 factorial, n2 factorial up to nk factorial. So we have everything now. The last thing to do is to look now at a combination with repetition. So the case of a combination with repetition is a little bit more tricky. And here the goal is to compute, like I showed in the slide, it's to compute the number of subsets of k blocks, but with possible repetition, meaning that each of those blocks can be of n different colors. And we can have repetitions of colors. So I rewrote here what we want to compute. And so for that, it turns out that that helps if we call xi, let's say, the number of, that's going to be the number of blocks with color, there are n different colors with color I. I can be anything from 1 to n. So number of blocks of color I, and I can be anything from 1 to n. Now, it's a little bit mysterious what I'm going to do right now, but this will become clear after. It turns out that it helps if we also look at yi equals xi plus 1. I'm going to tell you why soon. So xi plus 1. So the reason I'm introducing this one is because it turns out that it's possible that from those k blocks, none of them are of color I, let's say. Okay? And so that means that some of those xi can be equal to 0, which will be kind of problematic eventually. But if you call yi xi plus 1, then you force those numbers to be integers that are strictly positive. So now the next step is to observe that the number of such subsets is exactly the number of solutions. I mean, it's clear that if you add up x1, x2, up to xn, then you look at the total number of blocks you chose with color 1 or color 2 and so on up to color n, so those numbers should add up to k, okay? And it turns out that the number of subsets of k blocks in this case is going to be exactly the number of solutions of the equation So what we are looking for here is exactly the number of solutions of x1 plus x2 and so on up to xn, because we have n colors, equals k, but with the condition that all of those xi are non-negative integers. So I'm going to write xi is in n. So that means, for me, set of non-negative integers. So now, if instead you use those yi, then you see that the sum of the yi is going to be equal to, well, the same as the sum of the xn, okay, but plus n, because you add 1 for each of those variables. And so that's the same as the number of solutions of y1 plus yn equals this time k plus n, n plus k, I'm going to write, but with the new condition that yi should be a strictly positive integer. So I'm going to write n star. The star is to say that we remove 0, so this means that yi is a strictly positive integer. So now it turns out that you can visualize the solution of this equation using just a little picture. So what I'm going to do is just draw something like that, some dots. And so I want to have exactly n plus k of n. So it's dot number 1, number 2, number 3, and we go up to n plus k. And it's easy to see that the number of solutions of this equation, so here it's like if you think of, let's say y1 equals 3, you are going to extract this block of 3 dots, and then whatever size you have that corresponds to y2 and so on up to yn. So in fact, choosing a solution of this equation is the same as choosing let me see, we have n, so choosing n blocks from the set of n plus k dots, okay? And so, for instance, I'm going to have to choose like thin separation like that. The interpretation of those bars will mean that y1 equals 3, y2 equals 2, y3 equals 3, and y4 equals 2. And so that means also that from the point of view of the xi, that x1, x2, x3, x4, in the case n equals 4, are going to be equal to 2, 1, 2, 1, okay? And you see that in this case, because of those xi, and maybe I should change the picture and look at, for instance, this case here. You see that here, from the point of view of the yi, I still have exactly n blocks here. In my picture, n equals 4. But from the point of view of the xi, now the new values of the xi corresponds to 2, 0, 3, 1. And so from the point of view of the xi, we don't see this block. And so counting the number of solutions of this equation can be tricky, because that means that from this picture, you are going to extract maybe only one block or two or three up to n. While from the point of view of the yi, you have to extract exactly n blocks, okay? Because each of them has size at least one from this condition. So now, eventually what we kind of see from this little picture, and in fact there is a much more rigorous proof of that using some algebra that you can find in chapter 1 of my book, but I prefer just this picture at least for the video because that tells you more. I mean, that's more intuitive. From this picture, we can deduce really, we can really count the number of solutions of this equation. And so eventually you obtain the following answer. You see that because you have, I mean, the procedure here is exactly extracting n blocks, which corresponds to choosing n minus 1 red bars like that. And those n minus 1 red bars, they can be in any of 1, 2, 3, and so on, up to n minus k, n plus k minus 1 gaps between those dots. Okay? And so eventually the number of ways you can choose those bars, which is exactly the number of solutions of the common number of solutions of those two equations, is going to be so from n plus k minus 1, n plus k minus 1, I need to choose n minus 1 bars. And that gives you the solution here. So coming back to our little diagram, now we have a complete picture of all the formulas for all the six basic counting rules. And in the next few videos in this playlist, I'm going to give you examples of application where we have indeed to deal with symmetric probability spaces. And so two popular examples are, for instance, poker probabilities or the birthday problem. And you will see that to solve those two problems, poker probabilities, birthday problems, we need to use those counting rules.